Welcome to Colliding Worlds,
an art documentary in a 30-minute format.
Artists are interesting people. You're an interesting person.
We are with Daniel Stern. He may look familiar to you, his life as an actor, but we're more interested in his life as an artist. Why this type of art?
I wouldn't promote Chicano art if it wasn't really good.
Come with us as we take you on another journey.
We are here with kind of an interesting twist on a very unique and old-fashioned way of looking at things. We're with Crocheted Out of Plastic, and this is the artist. Welcome to Colliding World. And who are you, by the way?
I'm Darlyn Susan Yee.
And Darlyn Susan Yee, how in the world did you start to crochet plastic?
Well, it actually began with macrame. I started knotting vessels when I was a small child. I got fascinated by the knotted works. And I began doing that. It kind of grew into a love for fiber arts in general and brought it around to crochet and knitting. I was just passionate about making fabric.
As a small child, did your grandparents and your mom and all, did they all crochet and knit, or did you pick this up on your own?
Not so much. Just one family friend did a lot of needle crafts. And I've actually created some pieces in the plastic to memorialize her.
These are oversized.
Mm-hmm.
Is everything you do big and oversized, or are some things tiny and delicate?
I do a number of different things. I have three distinct bodies of work, plus I'm a yarn bomber. So there's a lot going on here.
Well, that's always a good thing.
Exactly. And I found at one point I was conflicted about the difference between public and private practice, art practice. And I realized that it was all public. If you think about it, you're putting it out there for everyone to view.
Here's a funny thing. I always wonder about people who create their work and hide it away and no one ever sees it. So I come to the question, are they really artists, or are they hobbyists, or what are they? Because by definition, art has to be seen.
Exactly.
So it's public. And these are very public.
Yes.
And they're very large. I mean, was it kind of, how was it received? Because people would, I can see some people looking at this going, this is crochet, this is knit. Tell me, why is this art?
I love doing pieces like this that make people think about, it'll remind them of what their grandparents or what their aunt and uncle did. It's fascinating to me to start the dialogue about family, about gender. This piece in particular, a hot pink apron that's larger than life,
totally
brings up gender issues. You think of home, and
you think of June Cleaver, you think of mom, you
yes.
think of, like, you don't think of Macho Man wearing a hot pink apron doing, but you, it, these are very
but
tied
might.
To gender roles. In this day and age,
you
do, but when I was a little kid, men did not wear frilly aprons. If they wore an apron at all, it was a white chef's apron. These are very specific. Even the half apron and the crochet purse are more, they're identified closely with women, not so
mm-hmm.
much as being kind of universal, but they're easily recognizable.
Exactly.
When people look at your work, do they scratch their heads and go, oh, this is cute, or do they get it or not get it?
I get a lot of comments about the process. People are more involved in well, how did you do that? What gauge hook do you use? And, you know, do you have a pattern for that? And actually, they're one of a kind. I never go back and do a second one, kind of like it. And
kind of like it's not fun.
Right. I just keep moving forward. And this particular piece started out as I was on a quest for neon colored yarns for a public art project. I was yarn bombing a tree at Pierce College, and I needed neon yarn. I was in the hardware store getting nails for another project, and I looked down, caught this neon plastic on the lower shelf. It's like, oh, I bet I could knit with that.
Oh, you! I love going to the hardware store because my local hardware store goes, oh my God, what are you going to do with it now?
Exactly.
Oh, it's going to be this, you know.
And my hardware store just looks at me like, oh, what now?
Yeah, exactly. You want me to cut it how?
And you want how many?
You know, it's kind of the neatest thing because you can create art from anything as long as your imagination will allow you to take mm-hmm. you there. And then it's just a question of when you sit there in front of the materials, go, I can make this work.
Yes.
And plastic is not always the easiest. It does have some stretch to it, but in some ways it's not very forgiving.
And it's not easy to slide on the needle, so it takes considerably longer.
This is the thing. Now, people look at this and they go, oh, this is a single crochet. That's so bloody easy. How many hours of work goes into a piece like this?
I would say that's a good 60 hours.
See, this is
and that's just for the fabrication of the fabric. And then there's the fabrication of the structure itself. It's on a metal frame to support it and make it easier for a patron to take it home with them today or to rehang it themselves.
When you work, do you work off the frame or do you work freehand just like a traditional
work? I work freehand. I don't use patterns. I just kind of make it up as I go along, which means I take some out every once in a while because it wasn't quite what I envisioned.
But it's good.
It's good. One of the comments that has been made about my work is that people can envision that I was close. I was this close to the work, working on it in my lap. And I am a part of that piece.
Here's the thing, here's the other question that comes out because we get into this discussion of what's fine art and what's craft.
Mm-hmm.
And there's always this like distinction that somebody has to make that, oh, this isn't art, this is craft because she did it by hand. But this isn't utilitarian.
We also, everyone else, painters, do it by hand. It's the same hands. What is digital? Using the digits.
I think it's kind of an interesting thing, though. What you've taken is something that's universally known. There's not a generation that is mm-hmm. not aware of this. There's a whole generation that grew up with like the granny square bags,
yes.
that whole hippie thing, and there's a whole generation that grew up around macrame.
Mm-hmm.
It resurrected itself, and it occasionally does. You've turned it into an art form. You've made vessels. You've made these out-of-sized pieces of Americana.
Yes.
Do you consider yourself a folk artist?
In a certain way, yes. There are differences in folk and craft and fine art. I think it's all one. It's whoever's looking at it who defines what it is.
All of the pieces are joyful. There's nothing sad or morose or scary about it. They're very joyful. And so you derive a lot of pleasure out of looking at it?
Yes.
Do you still derive a lot of pleasure out of creating each and everything?
Yes.
Do you surprise yourself?
Yes. The first, someone observed as I was working on this, I was turning pinker by the minute. And it was kind of true because there's a glow that comes about as you're working on a piece in the first place. And then you take on qualities of the piece, I think. And as this mass of pink grew in my lap, the reflection on my face was making me pink. So, but I really like working with fiber and string and yarn and so forth. You mentioned granny squares. I was one of many, many artists. I'm a core member of Yarn Bombing Los Angeles. And recently we covered the Craft and Folk Art Museum.
Yes, you did.
And we are very proud of that project and very happy that it's
That was an awesome project, but again, it was taking things that were familiar to everybody, giving a twist on them, mm-hmm. and made them different. And that's kind of what art is supposed to do, is like give you that twist. It doesn't have to be scary, it doesn't have to be political, it doesn't have to be anything, it just has to be admired.
It was on a fascinating level that people gravitated toward the project for various reasons. One was that, oh, it's a little square, I can do that. Oh, I've never learned how to crochet, this is a good excuse. I can crochet a square and be a part of a museum project. So there were all sorts of entry-level opportunities for people to get involved with the project, but the whole purpose of the project, how it came about, a few people of our members were sitting across the street at the tar pits and looking across and realizing the scale of the museum in comparison with the scale of Lakma down the street.
Exactly.
And the elements of scale and funding dollars and, you know, making all these interesting observations that only artists will. And
but it turned out to be such a great project, and it did two things. One, it engaged a group of people that normally wouldn't consider a museum. It engaged a group of people who probably never heard of the Folk Art Museum.
Yes.
And it brought attention to an art form, a style, a genre that often gets dismissed, especially in the shadows of LACMA and frankly the tar pits.
And it kept us busy for a year.
I can't imagine not being busy. I think what I like most about the work is it makes you smile.
Yes.
You see it in your eyes. I mean, you smile when you talk about it, and I can see you turning pink and orange and all kinds of neon colors. Where are you going to go from here? What's next?
I have been expanding the Body Cocoon series. It's a series of knitted structures that evoke the human form. And they're really fun. They swing in the breeze. They have similarities. They're inspired by Ruth Asawa's metal works,
mm-hmm.
and also some of Brancusi forms.
I think it's amazing what one can do with the simplest of materials and a basic thing, and you can turn it into wonderful art. And I really want to thank you for spending time with Colliding Worlds. I hope you all get to see this in some form. I'm looking forward to seeing the Body Cocoons. I'm looking forward to seeing Yarn Bombing somewhere else. And if you haven't seen it, you know it when you see it. You sit there and you wonder about it. Thank you so much for being a part of our world.
Thank you for coming.
Imagine the future where your body renews itself and the aging clock is reversed. The future is here. Introducing FDA-approved Aresis Imperfector Non-Surgical Face and Body Lift. Perfector Cellular Anti-Aging Face Treatment lifts and firms sagging skin, erases wrinkles, diminishes dark spots, and heals acne. Aresis Body Lift will instantly tighten loose skin, diminish cellulite, promote weight loss, and detoxify. Let the transformation begin by healing from within.
Are you the one to help people in need in the Coachella Valley? Call Well in the Desert today. Be the one to make a difference.
This portion of Colliding Worlds is brought to you by Daniel James Ryan Photography.
Hi, this is Angela Valenti Romeo. This is Colliding Worlds. I'm with Linda Sue Price, and we're looking at lights and more lights. You think you were in Hollywood? Talk to me about this. This seems like an unusual sort of take for a lady.
I have always liked neon, and I've always been attracted to neon, and I went to art school and I did painting and drawing, and then I got involved with motion graphics and worked in television making motion graphics. And then I was still looking, and I went and took a neon class at the Museum of Neon Art in Los Angeles. And this was it. This was my medium. And I made a piece, I sold it, made another piece, and then I wanted to make my third piece. And what I did was I took a piece of pipe cleaner and I wrapped it around a pencil, and then I popped it, and then it constructed this whole little model of what I wanted to make. And I took it to the bender that I'd been working with, and he had me try to draw a pattern and this, you know, this way and that way. And finally he said to me, if you want to do this, you're either going to have to go to someone who bends like this, or you're going to have to learn how to bend. And so he had such a comfortable environment. This is such a, for me it was very intimidating, it was industrial, and I felt comfortable there, and I thought it would be easier to learn how to bend than it would be to find an environment that was so supportive. So I started learning how to bend, and I burnt myself and cut myself, and I practiced for about 6 months. I played and played, and then he said to me, well, what's your intention? And I said, I want to learn how to bend. So then he put me on a more formal program. So I learned how to, I practice bending to pattern, but when I make my pieces, I bend free form, which is I heat the glass up and then I bend it and I just kind of play with it. And at one point in time, I got into spirals. It was just a shape that really appealed to me. And if you look at them closely, they're all different.
Yes.
And that's because they're organically bent. If a sign bender bent them, they would all be identical because they would have a pattern and they would be bending to it. And the interesting thing about these pieces is that because each tube animates, there's a transformer and a controller for each tube. So if you look at the back of this, it's a rat's nest of wiring.
Did that take a long time for you to figure out how to get them all to work in sequence? Or?
Well, this one, I actually went into After Effects and simulated it so that I would undergrip. I had certain color patterns that I was experimenting with that I wanted to put together, because when it's all lit up, it's really horrible clash of colors. But I was doing all this color blending by animating the tubes. And so I had it kind of all patterned out before.
So you're using your own version of Photoshop with After Effects. It's letting you play with the color and you can decide before you commit?
I'm not using Photoshop. I'm just using After Effects to simulate the animation.
That's like your version of it.
Mm-hmm.
But it lets you get the pattern down.
Right. On these pieces, I do that. Now, on other pieces, I don't use After Effects. The animation isn't that complicated. But this was really complicated. This one was based on the colors of Bryce National Park in Utah. And I arrived in a snowstorm, which is what this beaded line is representing. And actually, I arrived and it was sunset. It was beautiful, which is these colors. And the morning I woke up, it was snowing. And that was what that represented. And so these colors were all, I didn't really have to worry about the blending of them, whereas this one was specifically, I was using disharmonious colors to see what I could put together.
But it works. And it works because the way you have the sequence going, mm-hmm. it's like, you're right, they're not all coming out at you at once, and so it's not jarring to the eye or aesthetically unpleasing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But it's neon.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a gas, and it's light, and it's electric, mm-hmm. and it's, you know, boy toys.
Yes, yes, I love it. Well, I work in video production, which is heavily male, you know, and, you know, because of the technology and computers and everything, I just love it. I like technology. So that part of it appeals to me, the similarity to television with the luminosity and the glow.
When you're working on these, and again, because these are all different colors and there's different things going on, there's, you know, some are brighter, some are less, you've got clear, you've got all of these things going. When you're thinking about this, are you thinking finished product and working back, or are you thinking elements and I'm going to make it all work together?
Sometimes the piece leads me down a pathway. Sometimes I have an idea and I execute it. I've done a model and I execute it and it doesn't work. So I pull it apart and do something different.
But it looks like it's so much fun.
It is. It's like getting to go play. It's very much fun. I mean, from the bending to then putting it together and seeing how it looks. What I often do is I take a piece of cardboard. So I have an idea and I'm holding the tubes up going, how does this look and how does that look? But you can't really see it. So I get a piece of cardboard and about the size of what I want to work in as my canvas, and I poke holes and I stick the neon in and then I wire it up so I can see how it looks and I make adjustments, and I do that often too.
When you're working on these, talk to me about the process, because people think of neon and I think that it's a mystery to people. They don't know what makes it work, what makes neon neon.
Well, there's three gases. There's neon, there's argon, and there's krypton. And argon is this really lovely pale purple. It's very low light, which you can't really use with neon because it's so pale. But if you put a drop of mercury in, it becomes this lovely blue. And I have, that is right here, is this is pumped with argon mercury. So it's bright enough. This is pumped with argon mercury. Anything that's red, like this is red, that's pumped with neon, and then you have krypton in the background. So you have tubes that are colored, tubes that aren't colored, and this has a phosphor coating on the inside that kind of creates the color. This also has a phosphor coating that creates the color. So these two tubes are actually the same. This one has clear and this one's got phosphor, and they're slightly different colors. They're both pumped with the same gas. So it's a combination of gas, phosphor coating, and whether it's a colored tube or a not a colored tube.
Do you apply the gas? And then if you do you control how much of each goes in, or?
It's one gas per tube, so you can't mix gases.
Okay.
And no, I don't do the pumping. That's a whole other electrical process that you can easily electrocute yourself, and so I let somebody who's been doing it.
Something says it's like, you know, there's a point in the game where you cry uncle, and that would be mine.
Yes, yes.
Now the wiring that goes into this, you've used your cardboard, and it's like a pegboard for you to get them all situated. Now you've got them situated, you've got everything the way you think you want it. You've got to wire this up.
Mm-hmm.
Are you sure before you wire it up that it's exactly the way you want it and it's all going to work? Or is there room for you to, at the end, say, no, I got to move it around?
The wiring, by the time I get to the point of installing and I've got the holes drilled in the boxes and stuff, I'm pretty much locked in. You could, if you wanted, you could go in and put a plug and then patch it and paint it and move it. But pretty much by the time I'm to the point I'm drilling the holes, I'm locked in.
You're committed.
Yes.
You're committed. You know, you've got these pieces together. You've played with them. They move. They're light. How long will this neon last?
They could run, the tubes themselves could run for 50 to 100 years. The transformers, they'll last 10 to 20 years. They're very lightweight electronic transformers. What would happen with a neon tube is it would degas, and then you would take it out and repump it, and transformers can be replaced, so it's all fixable.
Were you attracted to neon as a child, like the neon signs, like you through Las Vegas and you go to neon junkyard?
Oh yeah, my favorite one in Las Vegas, there used to be this palm tree. Forget what hotel casino it was in front of, but it was just my favorite. I loved it. And then in Long Beach, California, on the traffic circle, they used to have a drive-in theater there that had a set of neon that was gorgeous.
When I was a little kid, neon was just always something that was like fascinating. When then I moved to New York, it became trendy. A lot of the clubs went back to neon, and you know, then it was always, you see that neon sign with that one bulb always burnt out. But there was something about neon that just sort of like picks up this whole Americana sort of thing. But this is kind of a your own little twist on all of it. Now, these are all, you know, fairly good size, you know, in terms of that they make a statement. They're not overly large. They're not overly small. How big do you want to go?
I'm trying to make neon so that people can have it in their houses. So I've tended to work smaller. I did a commission piece that was 9 feet by 9 feet. That was just a blast to do. It was kind of an imitation of a grand piano, and it's hung up above someone's grand piano, so they have this neon to inspire them.
And this leads me to this other question. The larger you get, I mean, so tubes themselves are going to be larger. Is there a critical size where it just doesn't work anymore between the gas or the tube?
No, because you have different sizes transformers that you could put on to cope with the length. I mean, each on the electronic transformers will carry up to a certain amount of feed. And if you got really huge, then you would go back to the old-fashioned, I forget what their format was, but they were the real heavy ones that they used in the old signs, and they could run more feet than the electronic ones.
Again, comes back to the transformer is what's going to eventually drive. You're not limited by the size of the tube, you're just limited by the capacity of the transformer. Is the transformer
a problem or an issue? I mean, is it, do you have to really think about that before you start?
No, once you've made your tubes and you've picked out what you're gonna do, you measure out how much tubing you have and you go over to a chart and you see what size of a transformer
you need. Science and numbers, my yes. two least favorite things. I'm fascinated with those little beads. I want to have little letters and I want to see the news go running across yes. here. How difficult was it to construct something like this with the illusion of the dots?
That's actually a specialty transformer called a bead maker. And they were designed originally to eliminate beads because krypton and neon will bead on their own and people didn't want them beading. So they invented this transformer to stop the beading. Well, I happen to like the beading, so I use the transformer to allow me to control the beading to set up a consistent bead.
And how long have you been doing this?
10 years.
It's pretty awesome. I mean, it's kind of one of those things, it's like you see it and you always think, wow, that'd be so cool to learn, and but you don't, and then you did. And it's pretty awesome. I mean, it looks like you must have a good time, but
I
you
do.
Have to keep thinking, you know, it's
always have to be focused. It's when you're bending and you're in the fires, you have to heat enough glass, get it hot enough, get it evenly heated, because if you don't, it'll kink on you. So it took me several months so that I could learn how to bend this shape without touching. Because see, like on some of these, you can tell I've gotten really close. Especially like on these, I've gotten really close. That one's really close. Once you get close, if you stick it, it's done. You have to start all over again. So and the hardest bend was this final bend here coming back, because I wanted it to have a nice swoop. And sometimes it would be kind of kinked, so I'd start over again.
Starting over, I mean, because you can't reuse the glass.
Mm-mm.
It's like you can't melt it and start all over.
No.
So you
get another tube, start all over again.
And it gets expensive. Mistakes are costly in something like this.
Well, you practice in the clear glass, it's about 50 cents a tube. And then you get into the more exotic glasses and they can go up to 10 bucks a tube.
50 cents a tube, we're talking about something that's
4 feet long.
See? Again, it's like it all adds up. It's a
it
game
does.
Of inches. It's a solitary activity.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Do you find it calming?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And I work in the studio of another neon artist, and so there's kind of a really good energy flow. And it's very much when you go in and you've done your 4 hours or 5 hours or 6 hours of bending, it's you're standing and you're in the fires and you're sweating and it's gritty. And
but at the end, you've accomplished something that's
yes.
uniquely yours and it can't be replicated.
Nope. Yep.
What other shapes are we going to see?
Well, if you look at the other piece that I have, it has the loops, and that's kind of my favorite form. This was something that I did after that, and I've gone back to the loops, and that's a more recent piece that I've done.
I think this is fantastic. I love the fact, to me, I look at neon, I look at all these, and I think it's a boys' game, and you've sort of turned that on its head, and these are just lovely. I think it's great fun. I hope you learn to make triangles next. Thank you so much for being a part of our little world.
Thank you.